That's the last talk. So since we learned this morning quite a lot on HIPIMs, I don't want to go too much into details. It's more about giving some highlights for HIPIMs technology. I will talk a little bit on using optical emission spectroscopy, getting some results there, on the behavior, how you can tailor the pulses. There are different operation modes you could do, and what you can measure from the floating or plasma potential with some flat probe measurements. I will have an example for retarding field energy analyzer and some Langmuir measurements. So just summing up a little bit all of the stuff we've heard until now, just in line with HIPIMs, or let me name it, highly ionized pulse plasma processes. That's also the name of the cost action we are running. And since you all found in the program that this morning session is dedicated as a HIPIMs cost session, I will come in the next slide, explain it a little bit. In general, HIPIMs or HIP processes, we will have a modification of the coding properties in the end, so from the perspective of the application, just by means of growing a film with ions or with a significant amount of ions instead of spotted particles. And there are several names available. I could extend the list even further, but the most prominent name is HIPIMS, high power impulse magnetron sputtering, or also high power pulse magnetron sputtering. But there is also called modulated pulse power sputtering. There are some modifications on all of that, or plasma oscillations. Some of those working points I will highlight. So cost in general is, I think, one of the oldest funding tools within the commission within Europe, and it's funding scientific networking. So it's just to bring together experts from different countries to exchange knowledge, to discuss things, to even support exchange trips. And we have in our action at the moment 22 cost countries. We have 4 non-cost partners and 2 additional partners to be connected. And there is the chance to send somebody to do some research in another country, in another lab. There is the chance to have workshops to contribute, like here with the conference, to have our own session and to just promote the technology and to gain a benefit by just exchanging the experience. So coming to the topic itself, using HIPIMs, we saw already several pictures. That's just a rough schematic. So in general, we have, of course, a negative voltage, but it was nicer to put it in positive for the feature. We have a more rectangular shaped voltage and some current evolving somewhat triangular shape. That's not properly correct, even for a single pulse, depending on the power supply you have, on the pulse duration, and so on. So if you look a little bit more into detail, combining the electrical data and optical emission spectroscopy, we can see here the voltage level, so more or less rectangular voltage shape, and then we have the ignition and then the current rising in that kind of triangular shape. And what is quite interesting is if we look at the optical emission in a time resolution. So we used what Harry was already presenting in collaboration with IFO Diagnostic System, pulse time trigger mode. I think there are several optical emission spectrometer available. That one was just in a triggered mode to really follow the lines. And so we get a nice time resolution and we can look at different emission lines, and we have 2 lines just growing linear during the pulse, more or less. That's neutral lines. They can be attributed to argon and to titanium. And then we can see that the ion lines for titanium 1 plus and 2 plus, 2 plus is starting later, but to some extent have a similar shape like the current. So they are to some extent replicating the current. So the question is, can we learn something on the HIPIMs discharge just by following the behavior of the emission curves? And so we just plotted the emission lines over the current we have. And what you can see is that we start with a type 0, we call it. We just have a linear increase from the beginning. And there might be a transition around 50 amps and some kind of saturation around 40 amps, and then we have some scatter, some noisy data, and from switching off the discharge, we see the return. And that line we can attribute to the neutral argon. Just for starting the discharge, we see already some glow, some excitement, and the neutral species. Then we see the type 1 we found emission a little bit later, shortly after ignition, at a threshold current of approximately 10 amps or a little bit less, and also linear increasing. And so that's for the neutral titanium. So we need a little bit energy. We need the plasma to just get started with the sputtering of the material itself. And if we increase with type 2 and type 3, the threshold current in that case for the discharge, so we can attribute a current, we can see we have a significant amount of 1 plus or 2 plus later on. We can attribute and can say, okay, there are probably different stages of levels of energy levels or current level for the discharge we can attribute with the cathode that are responsible for the discharge themselves and to creating single or double ionized ions. Still, with the unipolar pulses, we were looking at the plasma in a time-resolved 2D detector. So that's just a look through a window, a little bit on a linear target. It's a PK500 cathode, and we have a spectral range 400 to 850 nanometers, and the resolution depending on the wavelengths you have, and you just have a picture you build up, and then you can make a plasma video. So what you can see, in that case we had titanium oxide in the oxide mode, a titanium cathode running, average power is 12 kilowatts on the cathode, and there you can see, and I start the movie, the argon emission. From the bar here, you already can see the first picture is already when the pulse is starting. You can see already some light profile of the cathode, of the erosion. That will be for the argon neutral, for the argon ion emission, and for the oxygen neutrals. And also here you can see that was the position of the gas inlet. So there you will see some intensity distribution of that. So if I start it, you can see the intensity growing also from some kind of pressure gradient. You see a variation since we have just a point inlet over the whole cathode. So if I restart it again, you could see it's starting with the argon, and then the argon ions coming a little bit later in the intensity, and also the oxygen is later in the pulse taking over from the intensity of the discharge. So by that we can map what's happening during a pulse, learn a little bit more which species we have in front of the sputtering cathode. We have some measurements Till Wallendorf performed at Harrisite. You also can just pick up from your optical emission data from some emission lines. So here you have a top view of the sputtering cathode and an intensity profile reproducing the racetrack. So that's the size of 500 times 250 millimeters. And so that's for neutral argon. For the excitation, you see a broad distribution more or less in front of the cathode. If you're looking for the titanium emission, it's more focused on the racetrack and with increasing energy of the transition from the emission line. You can see it's getting more and more focused, and the discharge or the metal generation is really very close to the target in front of the racetrack. And also you see some pattern here that's known, that you have some oscillation also running at the target, or you will see in that case there might be also some effects of a kind of a cross corner effect from the magnetic array. Also, to learn a little bit how the plasma is propagating toward the chamber, so we used a four fiber setup, just looking parallel to the cathode, and we placed the fibers in each distance 1 centimeter further from the target. So that means fiber 1 has 1 centimeter, 2, 3, and 4 centimeters, just looking parallel to the target surface. And so if you look at the profile, we can see for the different fibers, starting with one, going to four, that the absolute intensity we measure is dropping, of course, because we are expanding towards the chamber with the cathode. But if we are looking in detail for each channel, and so we have a plot, several wavelengths over the pulse time, so a pulse time mode again, we see some emission lines in that case for argon. But if you look at it, the absolute intensity is getting less just with the distance to the cathode, but the features don't differ much. So it's always the same. You just see an expansion of the gas. And if you're looking for zirconium, preferred that spot here, you clearly can see that the main material, the main ions, are closely generated towards the target. The intensity is going down, but you're also losing some side of the ions you can see because it's just getting weaker from the plasma. So in general, we can learn a little bit what is happening with the optical emission spectroscopy in the pulse time mode. So once again, we have a range of wavelengths selected here, in that case nickel chrome and time, and then we can either make a cut in that direction and get the normal intensity profile we know from an optical emission spectroscopy, but from that plot we can choose any time during the pulse and learn what is evaluating how the plasma is evolving in the pulse. And for example, using one of the cuts, comparing for nickel chromium two different target stoichiometries, one can see that we normalize the species, the spectra on the chrome intensities, and then we can see that the nickel species are six times higher using 40-60 instead of 80-20, so some influence of the ionization and the target material used. We also can cut just along one line. If we do that, we get an intensity profile during the pulse, so some information how the ions behave or on existing ions during the pulse on the ionization. And that was leading to more rectangular shape, or the idea to say, okay, maybe we need a plateau, or it could be beneficial to have more rectangular shape. And this morning in one of the talks, we also had a more constant current mode. And in our case, we just did it with topping a second discharge on top of it, an additional voltage. And then we can nicely produce, here's the voltage, here's the current behavior, quite rectangular shape of the current during the whole pulse, and improve the ignition. So without the ignition pulse, we just have the triangular shape. With an additional ignition, we reach quite well the plateau. And if we look at the ion or at the emission lines, you also see we have a plateau level from the emission intensity. So that means that the ratio is not much varying during the pulse. Okay, that's more or less all on optical emission spectroscopy to get a little bit of feeling on how HyPIMS plasma is behaving, what we can learn for HyPIMS. And the question is, if we go to bipolar excitation, we also had one example this morning. The question is, if you have a bipolar arrangement, what is the influence between the first and the second pulse? If you have two cathodes just next to each other, a dual cathode arrangement, is there any influence from the first pulse to the second pulse in that arrangement? And how can we find out? And just to get rid of any side effects, we had a pulse mode, cathode 1, cathode 2, cathode 2, cathode 1. And the first example, first measurements we saw was first and second pulse, even so the same charging voltage, the same material and everything was the same, we got different peak current. So something's wrong from our thinking. It should be the same. So we had a closer look at the magnetic distribution of both cathodes, and we could clearly see there's a difference in the magnetic configuration that we used. And so we switched again and we say, okay, we use only one cathode for the first pulse and for the second pulse. So that in between we don't see, we modulate the off time between first and second pulse, and it should not be of any importance whether we have this pulse and that pulse, or whether we can say we look at a first pulse and then a second pulse where we just modulate the off time between the two pulses. So if we do so, we can see first and second pulse matching nicely, so we get rid of the problem with target erosion, with magnetic configuration, and so we now can learn a little bit more on the behavior. So we started with an off time of 4,900 microseconds and a pulse duration of 100 microseconds. We reduced it to 1,500 microseconds. We can see there's a little different. The slope or the current rise, the onset here, starts a little bit earlier in the second pulse. If we bring the pulses closer together, that effect becomes more prominent. And for just putting them together, 100 microseconds to one pulse, 100 microseconds off, 100 microseconds to second pulse, you see a significant difference for the same charging voltage that should be the same current rise we have, except we have some differences in plasma impedance and conductivity of the plasma and so on. And the largest effect, that was also the closest time we could bring together those two pulses, was 20 microseconds. And so there must be some influence. Just putting together for average power, we can say first pulse nearly stays the same, but the second pulse can be increased the closer it's to the first pulse for constant charge power, and that's the average power delivered per first and second pulse. So, and to understand it a little bit more in detail, we used a flat probe setup, and we were measuring the floating potential, and so that was just the resolution limit we had for the probe, so that's not the best resolution with the features, but we can see in both cases, for the first and the second pulse, we have a overshoot, a very high positive value for the potential, and then some leveling and some equilibrium. And already with the 1,500 microseconds, where we saw a little modification in the onset of the pulse, we can see the second pulse, the overshoot is not so much prominent, and we have a leveling somewhere else. If we come closer together, or come to the closest one, we nearly reach the same plateau level we have when switching off the first pulse and can put it on the second pulse. And that's something I think Harry already reported 2008 or so, that when we switch off the plasma, and we also heard yesterday, there are still remaining ions, remaining charged particles. So if we reignite it, we have the benefit of already having some ions still remaining in the plasma, and that we can nicely see also in at the target itself with the voltage current behavior, or with the current behavior, and we also can see it from the floating potential measurements in that case. Also the ion current that we measured, just the collected current, we can significantly see the increase of first pulse stays nearly the same from the shape, but of the second pulse and the broadening. So that means the closer two pulses are together, the second pulse is creating more and more ions, and that's measured at close to the substrate position. So we have some kind of pre-ionization with the first pulse, and then we benefit with a subsequent pulse in that case. To learn a little bit more, we also use the retarding field energy analyzer. The setup is already shown several times, so I'm going to some data on that. So just for quite high frequency, we can see with a low current density, it's not high PIMS, it's some mid-frequency, we can see from 7 to 25 milliamps per square centimeter. If you look at the kinetic energy, there's a shift of the peaks, and we end up with two peaks, and for the higher current density at the substrate, we get higher kinetic energy or ion energy with the second peak. Now going to high PIMS, when we did the measurements, we were a little bit restricted with 1 kHz. By now we have a triggered option from the pulse, so we can go to even lower frequencies. We tried to come in the high PIMS regime with 100 microseconds and even 50 microseconds and the repetition frequency of 1 kHz. And so what we can see is, in that case, here's the time axis and that's the bias. So energy over pulse time. It's just the opposite, like in the previous talk. And so we can see some delay or some negative current measurements we have, so probably some electrons arriving at the probe when igniting, or here igniting, and then just some propagation, and we can see that the ions, with increasing the current density, we get a significant increase. If we look for the shorter pulses in that case, we can see the maximum is shifted in time earlier, of course. We have some propagation there. But if we, what's more interesting, look at the ion energy distribution function, we can see for the lowest current density, we have just a maximum at low energies, and the higher we can get, so closer, shorter pulses and higher current density in that case, the higher the energy and also the distribution, the broadening of the energy tail of the ions we have. Coming to the last part of my talk, it's a little bit different from the excitation. That's a new kind or new development of power supply where you have some oscillations, you have voltage oscillations, and you build up a longer pulse instead of having a constant 500 microsecond pulse or whatever. You intersect that pulse with several oscillations, and then you can build up oscillations in a range of 5 to 20 microseconds nominal pulse widths or oscillation widths, and then you can modulate the frequency in between in the rep rate going up to 62.5 kilohertz. And so what we had was one plasma on, in that case it's titanium aluminum, on time 60 microseconds, off time 6 microseconds, so very short sequence of the pulses, and in total almost 500 microseconds. And peak current was varied 25 amps and 100 amps, so that's 0.2 to 0.5, 0.6 amps per square centimeter for that case. And what we can see is that for the higher peak current, we have a larger oscillating in the voltage, but we have a behavior of the current one would also know or is familiar with long high-pulse pulses. If you have a high-pulse discharge of 500 microseconds, we get a similar pulse. And also what I want to emphasize or point out, the voltage in that oscillations is never reaching the ground level or the reference level, but it's always negative in that case. And if we look at electron and ion density, we see we have some evolution, but it's nearly a more or less constant line or slightly dropping during the discharge, a little bit higher ion density than electron density. Going to the higher peak current, the 100 amps, so I'm comparing 25 amps, 100 amps now in the following slides. You see they are getting closer together. The absolute value, the absolute density is getting higher in that case, but we can see just the decay during the pulse. And if we look at the floating potential and the plasma potential, we see floating potential somewhat negative, plasma potential is positive. And in that case, the trigger was not set properly, so we just caught the end of the pulse. But you see the replication or some oscillation also in the floating potential, and then going to zero and some more noise for the higher peak current. And the electron temperature, just during ignition, we have an overshoot. We have really hot electrons. We have electron temperature up to 20 eV or so. But the main or average electron temperature is in the range of 1 to 2 or around 2 electron volts in that setup. For the high peak current, there is no significant difference in that behavior. And so the interesting part is what will happen if you just make single pulses after each other, one after each other, and then repeat that sequence for peak current again, 25 and 100 amps. And now we can see that we are reaching the reference voltage level again between the pulses. So nothing specific different for the electron ion density, neither for the 25 amps nor for the 100 amps. And only thing is that we can see we increase with the peak current, we increase the electron ion density. But that's very nice to see here, the floating potential between the pulses is reaching ground level again. It's going to zero back again, and that oscillations, there might be, that's a measurement at the substrate side. So we really can see the modulation of the potential. That means on the other side, if you have the same behavior at the cathode, we are decharging the cathode every time, or we are reducing the potential drop at the cathode each time. That would be, the idea is that we normally in high pumps back attract the ions and go towards the self-spot ring. And in that case, if we intermit it, we release the ions to propagate towards the substrate. But that's something to has to be proven in more detail. And if we increase, we can see, okay, we have a larger variation of the potential, and the average value is a little bit higher than before in that case. Also, the electron temperature is different, so we can see always an overshoot for exciting with each single pulse. And that was it already. So I didn't prepare any summary since I was touching three or four different subjects on that. And the only thing I want to acknowledge is, of course, the support from the cost action and the support from Impedance, C-Pulse, and Haydn for providing equipment just for the experiments, for the measurement. And one announcement dedicated to HiPIMS. We will have the fourth HiPIMS International Conference in Braunschweig next year in June, and the deadline for the submission of abstracts is 6th of December. There is more information on that. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ralph, for this very nice overview. Are there any questions about the topic?
Yeah. Thank you for a very interesting talk. I have a question about you. In the latter part of your presentation, you showed us the oscillatory plasma generation.
Sorry?
And
yeah.
Oscillation.
Yes.
Plasma will be oscillation. And the former part, you didn't show us. What's the critical difference in the experimental condition? Which you, one side you get the no oscillation, the other side you get oscillation.
The question is, and that's something we try to understand, what are the oscillations doing to the film growth? And that's something, at the moment, we cannot say in detail to that. The conventional mode is that, in most of the cases, you just have a single pulse, maybe extended to several hundred microseconds, have a long pulse, and you have a potential, also a quite negative potential at the cathode. What we have seen with the oscillations, or one benefit using the oscillations, was when we were going to reactive sputtering, when we were using oxides. So that was the only setup at the moment we were using to have a at least visible arc-free discharge. When we were running, when we were testing it, we had a around half meter size cathode, so 600 square centimeter target area of aluminum running in a pure oxygen discharge without any argon, only oxygen, and no visible arcing.
So
just by this small oscillations, you're more shifting towards a behavior you would expect for a ceramic material or other material running in an RF mode that you decharge, and you don't have any hard arcs in that case. So that's something where we see it might be beneficial. There might be other advantages. We're trying to understand what is happening, but the plasma is behaving completely different. That's what we can see from the measurements.
So the power source itself is the same. Power source, I mean the voltage source is the same, but the plasma oscillates.
It's a different power supply. It's a different company providing the power supply. So there are, I think today, 6 or 7 different commercial power supplies for HiPIMS you could buy. And
No. My question is that you do not intentionally overlap the oscillating RF on the DC pulse.
No, we don't have an RF. It's just a pulsed supply. It's an oscillatory circuit, and we just have some pulsing. And in the one case, we build up a pulse with several micropulses or oscillations, and in the other case, we just have a single pulse. And there we see a different behavior. Also, what I didn't show here from the lung wave measurements, we can see that when we switch off with one of the unipolar high-pumps power supplies, we get an overshoot also from the switching again. We get a second peak from the electrons when we switch off.
As for the current oscillation, I can understand, but the as for voltage also oscillating. So yes. I wondered why, but that could also be due to the nature of the kinds of power source.
That's from the power source, yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Are there any more questions? You mentioned that when you intermittently switch off the voltage during the pulse, you may release ions and enhance the flux to the substrate in that way. Did you measure anything like a deposition rate or ion flux to support that?
I think we have some measurements. Frank did, but I'm at the moment not sure on the behavior. I think in general the oscillations give a lower rate, what we've seen for that system. But I have no data to really compare it. The only thing I can see is when we were modulating, in the case we just have the oscillations very close, we see there is no big difference from the plasma potential or from the from the behavior in general for a long high pumps pulse and for the oscillation. So a significant difference or effect is just given when we bring the oscillations to that point that they just reach zero and then start again. Then we see a difference in the potential, in floating potential and everything. But to correlate it to the rate, we have some first data on that, but we are looking more into detail at the moment on that. So I cannot say it's this or that, but there might be other effects like the power conversion if you would correlate the average power you introduce to the depth rate you realize. That's something we know also from a unipolar power supply. If we have very short pulses, we lose a lot of energy in the power supply for the switching, for everything. If the pulses get longer, we can convert most of the energy in the pulse. And that's something just from the behavior of the power supply itself. But that should be something for further investigations to really look in detail. What's the efficiency? What's the effective outcome of ions to neutrals and the behavior, what you can measure there.
Okay. Are there any more questions? Well, it's not the case. It's time to speak once again.